Thank you. Well, yeah, I mean, I'm not making it up anymore. I'm not going to shut up. That's the one I'm sitting here with.
Service. Those colors are different than what we're used to, so.
But, we're not here to disagree. And I go to first green division next. So that would be great.
Yeah, so.
You'll fit in.
Really?
Thank you. Ceremony will commence shortly. Everyone is asked to take this opportunity to verify that cell phones and other devices are silenced. Only military personnel on stage will remain covered throughout the ceremony.
Thank you.
Good morning and welcome to the change of command ceremony for Captain Scott Davis and Captain Philip Malone. The official party will be arriving in a few minutes.
It's been a while since we've done
right. So with the president with 39, it was gotta go.
Right.
Yeah.
I know, right? What we do, I just. And we're live streaming. Yeah, we're streaming. People are watching. I know. I'll double check. Double check. Matt, is this live streaming? Yes, ma'am, we'll make sure that that's available to you as well, so they would just. We'll double check.
There you go, mask is here.
Now, we're.
You're all good.
Yeah.
Yes, Scott, you said we're up.
Right. Right now, he's like, he's not.
Oh, yeah, right.
Because I'm wondering that true confession. So I do that.
Yeah, then I.
I know I did.
Post in, post the side, boys.
Left or right face.
Guests, please rise for the arrival of the official party and remain standing for colors and the invocation. Uniformed personnel are asked to cover at this time. Strike four bells. Captain, United States Navy, arriving. Strike four bells. Captain, United States Navy, arriving. Strike four bells. Engineering Duty Officer School, arriving. Strike eight bells. Naval Sea Systems Command, arriving. Parade the colors.
freeze it. Arms. Ready, two.
Ladies and gentlemen, the national anthem. Retire the colors.
Shoulder. Arm.
Lieutenant Kenyon, Chaplain Corps, United States Navy, will offer the invocation.
Let us pray. Giver of life and Almighty Lord our God, today we come to you with deep gratitude in our hearts for all the gifts you give us each day. What an honor to call upon you on behalf of our military community and knowing that we're invited to ask your presence in our midst. We remember to you today Captain Scott Davis and his wife Lori and their daughter McKenna. His time here at Engineering Duty Officer School, Port Hueneme, is ending, and he's moving to new places you've called him to serve. We ask that you keep your hand of grace upon him as he perseveres to new horizons. Bless his family in this new season of life. Today, we also lift to you a new leader for the Engineering Duty Officer School, Captain Philip Malone. Grant abundant blessings upon him, his wife Monica, and their four children. I ask that you give him wisdom to weather the storms of his time here, and that he may learn from them. Give him the fortitude to be a man of integrity and to have the compassion that will enable him to be a leader in a way that is redemptive and capable. As he will be given this command today, help him to accept it as a sacred trust that he will guard and lead. We pray also for Monica and their family. Give them all strength to weather the difficulties of supporting Captain Malone in his new role, and a cheerful spirit to enjoy all of life with laughter and love. I implore your blessings for the men and women of Engineering Duty Officer School. Your strength enables us to protect others. Your providence keeps us safe. Help us to turn our hearts towards you each and every day. It is in your name that we pray. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Uniformed personnel may uncover at this time. Post the side boys.
Side boys. Right. Faith. Forward. Mark.
Lieutenant Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my pleasure to introduce the commanding officer of the Engineering Duty Officer School, Captain Scott Davis.
Good morning. Welcome to the Engineering Duty Officer School Change of Command. Find the right tab here. Okay. Admiral, John, Chaps, family, friends, welcome and so glad to have you here today. I am truly honored to and humbled this morning to introduce Vice Admiral Bill Galinis, the Commander of Naval Sea Systems Command, and our community sponsor as our guest speaker today. The EDO school is often referred to as the heart of the EDO community, so it's only fitting that the head of that community preside over this change of command. You can read his impressive biography in the program, so I'll just hit a few highlights for you this morning. Admiral Galinis has spent 38 years serving our country as a naval officer. The last 30 years have been as an engineering duty officer, where he's held numerous positions of increasing responsibility in shipbuilding, maintenance, and repair, to include as program executive program manager for the LP-17 ship class, and as program executive officer for ships, where he oversaw all surface ship and shipbuilding programs, except the aircraft carriers and submarines. He also served as a commander at Naval Regional Maintenance Center, where he responsible for all surface ship maintenance, modernization, and repair across the globe. These positions prepared him well for his current assignment as the commander of Naval Sea Systems Command, where he leads an organization of close to 80,000 military and civilian personnel in all aspects of acquisition, program management, research and development, maintenance and repair of the Navy ships and submarines. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Vice Admiral Bill Galinis.
Hey, good morning, everybody. What a great day, you know, a great Navy day. I'll tell you, these are always bittersweet events, right? To bid farewell to an officer, a commanding officer has done a tremendous job, but at the same time, we get an opportunity to welcome another leader as they step into to take the helm here. So friends and family of the Engineering Duty Officer School, and a special welcome to Scott and Phil's family. It's so good to have you all here today. Mom and Dad from Ohio, dude, what a lot to be proud of here today. Let me tell you, Scott has really done a tremendous job. So really a lot to be proud of. Scott, thanks again for the opportunity to be here and to talk a little bit this morning. It really is a wonderful feeling to be part of this time-honored tradition where Captain Malone will relieve Captain Davis as the next commander of this remarkable national asset, the Engineering Duty Officer School. You know, I went through this school a few years ago, and while many things have changed, including the location, how many people remember where Mare Island was? Anybody? Yeah, a few, okay. You know, the commanders, I'll tell you, if you walk the hall and you look at the people who have led this school, it really is kind of a who's who in the engineering duty officer community. And then, of course, the curriculum that has really been refined. And we'll talk a little bit more about that here in a little bit. But I will tell you the one thing that always remains the same is the caliber of people that we task to lead this school. And because of the importance of what it does for our community, we choose the best of the best to lead our school. And that's certainly true of the two officers that we will honor here today. And I'm humbled again to have the opportunity to officiate this ceremony for two incredible naval officers, Captain Scott Davis and Captain Philip Malone. You know, it takes a lot of courage and determination to take up the mantle of training the next generation of naval engineers. And I think it's pretty clear that the Navy got it right when we selected Captain Davis to take that position about 3 years ago. Over his command tour, Scott has helped to mold and shape our engineering leaders who will guide us through this era of great power competition that we're in. And this is no small task. And for that, on behalf of our entire engineering duty officer community, the entire Navy and our country, Scott, I say thank you to you and to your family for what you've done here while you were at the school. I would like to take a moment to extend a special welcome again to the Davis and the Malone families. Our military spouses do not wear the uniform, and generally they don't receive the medals or the accolades that their loved ones do. But make no mistake about it, they serve our country just as much as those who wear the nation's cloth. We all know that our wives or spouses serve right alongside of us. The military, and especially the Navy, ask a lot of our families. And the Scott and Phillips family have been with them through it all. Every duty station change, every deployment, every new assignment brings new experiences, but also, frankly, puts some strain on the family. So, Lori, for all you have done, for your sacrifices in support of Scott and your family throughout Scott's absolutely stellar career, I want to personally thank you. I want to thank you for your service to our Navy and to our country. And to McKenna, your love and support during your dad's career has also been very phenomenal. Everything I said about your mom goes double for you because you've had the added burden of going from school to school, seemingly in constant motion. I think we can all learn from your toughness and resiliency. On Captain Malone's side, I'd like to welcome Philip's wife, Monica, who has demonstrated again a tremendous amount of dedication to her family and to our Navy. It's never easy to start over in a new place and learn the lay of the land. Creating a new life for you, your family, in a new location always brings challenges. For your services and sacrifices, I thank you, and I'm very happy that you could be here today. Philip and Monica have four children, James, Maura, Aaron, and Megan. And although they're not here today, we do thank them for their sacrifices as well. Philip and Monica's children have been on this journey with them from the start. And again, their adaptability and the strength should inspire all of us, and we're grateful for their service. So today, as a custom and as the guest speaker, I'm charged with highlighting Scott's successes throughout his career, and in particular, during his time here as the Engineering Duty Officer School Commanding Officer. So I will tell you, if we were to do that, it might be a relatively short speech. Seriously, though, we'll get a chance to highlight those successes. But first, I'd like to take a few moments to address the talented and dedicated team here at the Engineering Duty Officer School. And while this day is supposed to be about the outgoing commander, when I asked Scott about his most inspirational memories while serving here as a commanding officer, Scott did not hesitate to highlight his team. And to highlight how that team has consistently looked for opportunities to improve the programs here at the schoolhouse, and how recently they stepped up and rose to the challenge of educating during the COVID-19 pandemic, we'll talk a little bit about that. You know, it's no secret that education and training is the backbone of our Navy, and especially when it comes to our engineering duty officers. The work the team here does at our school is integral in delivering the combat capability and for keeping our ships forward deployed where they can help ensure peace and win in the case of combat. With that in mind, under Scott's leadership, the Engineering Duty Officer School performed superbly through the COVID-19 pandemic. And I would offer it was probably one of the toughest challenges this team faced. Like many organizations, they went from 0 to 100% telework overnight, and they continued to do their duty even through staffing shortages. What was most impressive, however, and most important to our community, was the ingenuity and flexibility that the team demonstrated in developing and pivoting to a virtual learning environment that enabled the successful continued training of our engineering duty officers. And to quote Scott, this was truly an inspirational effort. Over the last 15 months, the team pivoted to this virtual environment while still maintaining a high quality of course material and instruction. And I'm sure there was a lot of frustration, probably caused by the folks that Scott works for, and maybe some head scratching, and most certainly, and all of us have been there, cursing of the IT gremlins that seem to live in our networks. But the team continued to deliver quality education to our engineering duty officers. So to the team in attendance today, and for those who couldn't make it, thank you for your astounding work and your dedication to our Navy. A leader is only as good as their team, and the same could be said in reverse. This sentiment is exemplified by the great team that is here with us today, and one of the most effective leaders to guide them during the pandemic. Phil, while there's been a fair amount of change across this talented team, you're inheriting a culture that will get the job done, and I'm sure you'll do well. I'm confident you'll lead them to success, just as Scott did. Now let's get on to Captain Davis. So one of the things we do during these events is really kind of talk about some of the successes of our outgoing officers. And Scott will humbly tell you, as I mentioned, that he has a great team. And given their accomplishment, that's an understatement. But every team needs a captain, a true leader. And I will tell you, there is no doubt that Scott has played an instrumental role in making a real difference here at our Engineering Duty Officer School. Scott has all the qualities of a superb naval officer. And while I could touch on his numerous qualities, that would take a lot more time than we have here today. So instead, I'll just focus on two of the attributes that I've seen and witnessed that I believe has exemplified his career, and that's adaptability and innovation. Scott entered the service as a surface warfare officer, serving across three different ship classes. It was during these initial tours that he gained a solid foundation of operational experience. But it was really the calling of the engineering duty officer community that drew Scott. His early frenetic life as a SWO, who moved from one issue or one problem to another, helped inform his leadership style that we will benefit for many years to come. He used that experience to push the team to look at things differently and to make changes when things weren't working as they should. This experience would provide Scott with his adaptability and innovative thought process that he would put to use throughout his career. These traits have served Scott well, and we will continue to benefit from Scott's innovative efforts here at the Engineering Duty Officer School for many years to come. So I've already talked about the transition the school made from changing from an in-person learning environment to a virtual environment. And that effort in itself was tremendous. And while it was certainly a feat to be recognized, the work that really set the stage for this was actually the work the team accomplished well before March of 2020. That being the complete overhaul of the curriculum and the reference material that we use here at the schoolhouse. Not only did he and his team look at the curriculum and think that it needed to be updated to fit today's technology and standards, and it certainly did, they got rid of the paper course book and went all electronic. Today's students do not have to carry around that 15-pound binder, which many of us are all too familiar with. The modernization of the EDO basic core curriculum, transitioning from death by PowerPoint, as we say, to a multi-platform delivery system that incorporates a modern adult style of learning that includes interactive course pre-work, exercise, gamification, and videos to keep the students engaged in learning has absolutely been a game changer. Scott led this effort and spearheaded the replacement of these legacy hard copy course slides to a new learning management system that has absolutely improved the level of learning across our basic course. This transformational change replaced the 15-pound binder that I previously mentioned with Chromebooks loaded with searchable PDF files and upgraded courseware that the students not only use in the schoolhouse, but will take with them when they leave and hopefully use during the course of their career. These innovations were founded really before the COVID-19 pandemic, making it much more effective for teachers and students to communicate, and made the transition from fully in-person learning to virtual a success. The modernization was a long time coming, honestly. Scott saw the problem that needed to be fixed, developed an innovative solution, and he moved out smartly with a well-developed plan to make it happen. And in the process, made the Engineering Duty Officer School much better. These are the marks of a true leader, and I believe the impact that this is going to have on our community is transformational. You've unshackled our future generations from the past and allowed the curriculum to grow and change as fast as technology is changing today. That effort had a tremendous and very positive impact on our training efforts and will be felt for years to come. And while I've known Scott for many years, personally, It was really only over the last 3 years that I had a chance to work closely with him while he was the commanding officer here at the schoolhouse. It is during this time that I've gotten to know Scott and really come to rely not only on his innovative thought process, but his solid intellect, his ability to transition strategy to execution, and his tremendous communication skills. And while the course material change and the shift from in-person learning to a virtual environment were no doubt tremendous and much needed, I would argue that Scott's most enduring change, and frankly, his legacy here at the schoolhouse, will be the work that Scott did in transforming our community's leadership development framework. The Engineering Duty Officer Leadership Development Framework stems from our CNO's leadership requirements, and it's a customized framework that's used throughout the engineering duty officer community today. Scott and his team did an amazing job in building this framework. Last year, when this effort was being briefed to Navy leadership, it was our Vice Chief of Naval Operations that really called it the gold standard. And I'll tell you, it truly is. I will tell you that Scott took a keen interest in the development of this particular topic. Scott led the development and maturing of this effort, briefing our community flag leadership. He personally championed the development of his students in this area by briefing and discussing this topic with each student coming through the EDO school. He presents a leading people module, which touches on leadership approaches and how to be a successful leader and the officer's qualifications tour and throughout their career. And if that wasn't enough, he implemented ethics modules that centered around acquisition and leadership and instituted a student-led inclusion and diversity roundtable discussion that has received outstanding feedback from each class that has come through the schoolhouse. It's amazing to think that on top of everything else, under Scott's leadership, you know, four key leadership development and continual learning objectives have continued to grow and mature across our community. These include the EDO leadership podcast that many of us have taken part of, a LinkedIn learning, self-paced learning path that really has been a game changer in how we kind of get information out to our community, the EDO community book club that really focuses on the development of leadership and how to lead teams, and then the LinkedIn leader development group that Scott established. Having had the opportunity to work with Scott, you can see his fingerprints on this initiative. As Scott architected and customized this leadership initiative, he leveraged his qualities as a superb naval officer. And while I could touch on his numerous qualities, we just don't have the time to do that here this morning. So instead, I'll go back to the two attributes that I mentioned earlier, his adaptability and innovation. On a more personal note, as leaders, we all have an important opportunity, and frankly, a requirement to mentor and develop those under our charge. One member of Scott's staff told me that this was not the first time that she had worked for Scott. In fact, Captain Niagara had a wonderful story to tell Scott about when you were the chief engineer over at Port Hueneme, and you were her certifying officer. At the time, Nicole was a surface warfare officer, but was trying to become an engineering duty officer. It was Scott who wrote the letter of recommendation that got her accepted to the engineering duty officer community in the spring of 2013. And Nicole says, and I quote, "Constant scrutiny, intense pressure, she qualified within 12 months, which for our qualification process is pretty impressive. This might all seem mundane, but what it really shows is the impact that as a leader, Scott had on his people. You get them out of their comfort zones, assign them difficult but possible tasks, and ensure their success, not just in the moment, but in their future as well. Captain Nigro is just one example of many that have benefited from Scott's leadership. One last quote from Nicole, she said, and I quote, "You have been the guiding force in her career, and she would not be where she is today without it. I could think of no higher praise, Scott, so well done." And there are many others out there that Scott has mentored and led along the way. So over the course of your career, you've been a true leader. in the definition of the word, and the Navy has benefited, Scott, from your efforts. What's more, you've carried on a tradition within the ED community where constant mentorship is our norm. We, by purpose, work hard to ensure those coming behind us are set up to succeed and lead when their time comes. And you exemplify the best in our community. With all the accomplishments and accolades out of the way, I would like to again thank the real force behind the fleet, and that is the families of our sailors. We ask a lot of our families, and again, I am grateful that they, and I mean they, accepted the challenges throughout years of service. So again, Lori and McKenna, thank you for your service and the support that you have provided. Scott, well done, shipmate. You should be incredibly proud of what you and your team has accomplished during your watch. You set the bar high. So the Navy never fails to find talent and talented leaders to come in behind those who are departing. In this case, we have another absolutely incredible leader coming in behind Scott and Captain Philip Malone. Phil, you've proven yourself to be a talented and knowledgeable leader and ready for anything. Throughout your career, your performance has absolutely been rock solid. Starting from your time at the Merchant Marine Academy through your various sea tours, the time as reactor officer on Lincoln, the program manager of PMS 379, and your work with the carrier program that frankly is changing, is providing game-changing performance to our fleet today, and now as a CO of our schoolhouse. You are ready for this demanding but incredibly important command. I thank you and your bride, Monica, for taking on this assignment. Phil, I'm confident you will continue to lead our community training programs. And yes, you have some big shoes to fill, but when you combine your exemplary career with the team you have, I have no doubt that the EDO school is set for bigger expectations. You're ready to take this adventure, and I look forward to seeing the officers that come out of this school during your tenure. To Monica and James, Maura, Aaron, and Megan, the journey isn't over yet, so we thank you for your continued support. To the men and women of the Engineering Duty Officer School, thank you for your dedicated and tireless service. In this era of great power competition, it's the Navy who's going to be called upon more than ever to ensure that we protect our freedom around the world. And we have the world's greatest Navy, built in large part because of the tremendous work done here at the Engineering Duty Officer School. May God bless the EDO community, our great Navy, and the United States of America. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my pleasure to introduce the Naval Education and Training Command, Deputy for Training Operations, Captain John Boone.
Morning, Admiral. Distinguished guests, visitors, family, the schoolhouse, Bill Scott, thank you. It's been a while since I've been in California, and certainly, you know, I've missed a lot of things, with the exception of driving up through L.A. yesterday. So, happy to be here. I did sneak down the coast, though, and I got a look at that beautiful Pacific Ocean, and certainly reminds me of the Navy, and it was a perfect intro to a wonderful occasion. So happy to be here. And Scott, it's an honor to be here representing Rear Admiral Garvin on behalf of Naval Education and Training Command. So with that said, the Admiral passes his admiration and appreciation for all you've done over the past couple of years. And as mentioned, there's been a lot of obstacles, a lot of innovative ideas and great things that you've accomplished, and certainly coming and overcoming the COVID-19 environment, getting your team ramped up and continuing to accomplish the mission, as the Admiral mentioned, has been huge and has made TAG and now my job much easier. Phil, I'm looking forward to you carrying that mantle for us and working together. So that'll be a good thing. And yes, for the families, just the I know the sacrifice and the dedication that comes from following through and the moves and everything else. So that is also truly appreciated. I'm going to keep my remarks short and sweet, so to speak. But it is a privilege to present to you your well-earned award on behalf of Commander Naval Education Training Command.
Captain Davis, please join Captain Boone on stage. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the presentation of the military award. Captain Boone will now present the Legion of Merit to Captain Scott Davis. The President of the United States of America takes pleasure in presenting the Legion of Merit to Captain Scott A. Davis, United States Navy, for service as set forth in the following citation: for exceptionally meritorious conduct in the performance of outstanding service as commanding officer, Engineering Duty Officer School, Port Hueneme, California, from August 2018 to May 2021. Captain Davis distinguished himself throughout his exceptional character, unlimited resilience, and keen judgment, providing inspirational leadership to significantly enhance mission effectiveness and prepare over 250 students for careers as engineering duty officers. He led the school throughout the coronavirus global pandemic, ensuring safety of all staff and students while maintaining school throughput by rapidly implementing virtual course execution and establishing safety protocols to support critical accession pipeline in residence training. Captain Davis guided the school in a transition to the digital age, which enabled the curriculum overhaul from traditional lecture-based format to an engaging problem-based learning environment. His innovation led the institutionalization of the Chief of Naval Operations Leadership Development Framework for the Engineering Duty Officer Community, identified as the gold standard and a catalyst for the character development of our next generation of inspirational leaders. Captain Davis's superior performance of duties highlights the culmination of 30 years of honorable and dedicated service. By his dynamic direction, keen judgment, and loyal devotion to duty, Captain Davis reflected great credit upon himself and upheld the highest traditions of the United States Naval Service. For the President, John B. Nowell, Jr., Vice Admiral, United States Navy. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Captain Davis, Commanding Officer, Engineering Duty Officers.
All right, here we go. Admiral, I don't know how you got a copy of my speech, but somehow you did. So you're going to hear some of the same things again. So bear with me, please. So thank you all. Good morning. Thanks for being here. I saw Peter and Catherine. Thanks for coming in. Thanks. Glad you make it. I hope they didn't stop you and frisk you at the gate or anything like that. But
no. I think we paid them off.
Okay. All right. Admiral Captain Boone, Chaplain Captain Malone, Captain Hoffman, fellow family, friends, both in person and virtually, thanks for coming. And especially my EDO school staff, thanks for being here and thanks for putting this together. So a special round of applause, please, to the entire staff and team for helping to put this together. You will hear often and heard often how small they are. So they really are. We are eight people, really seven, because we don't do anything, but put all this together. So thank you so much for that, specifically Lenora, Captain Nigro, and Matt, all your help in pushing me forward with this, make decisions on in-person versus virtual. Do you want to stream this? I'm like, I've never streamed anything in my life before. So sure, let's do that. Where is Eduardo? Lieutenant J.G. Contreras, thank you very much for all your help in this as well. So could not have happened without all of your support. And I really appreciate that. As many of you probably know, if you know me at all, I'm not one for pomp and circumstance. I'm happy to fade in the background and just kind of be there in the corner. But this is certainly not how I envisioned this day, right? I did probably envision a little more pomp. But this is fine. It is what it is. And I think it's appropriate for the times. So as was said, traditionally, this would not only be my change of command, but also my retirement. However, given the circumstances, we have chosen as a family to do that at a date later when our family can be together. So we'll be doing that in Ohio, somewhere between my family and Lori's family. Probably Columbus, go Bucks. Nothing from Keith on that, okay. So that will be probably later this summer. So my comments today will primarily be focused on my time here at the school. But I can't promise that I won't wax once or twice. You'll see when that is. So upon taking the command 3 years ago, I recognized the significant role that I was taking on. Aside from just another assignment, I was shifting from the focus of growing and developing future combat systems program managers for the personal and professional development of the entire engineering duty officer community. In fulfilling this responsibility, I committed to three primary lines of effort. First was to increase the efficacy of the school by extending the learning experience beyond the formal classroom and by modernizing the content and method of delivery of the course material, which Admiral Galinis so aptly explained this morning. We achieved this objective by embracing technologies such as electronic classroom, collaborative learning environments. Gone is the, I had 10-pound binder, so it must have been gotten a little smaller from when you went through, sir. But yeah, it was a large binder, about 2,000 PowerPoint slides, double-sided, two slides per page, that we would lug around from command to command. I think I got rid of mine maybe two or three tours ago. I'm not sure. You still have yours, Admiral? It's probably not. So we now have an editable PDF. So we could not have done that without the great support of my then boss, Admiral Kozad, and my current boss, Admiral Garvin, who challenged me to lean forward. He recognized the advantage we had as a small school to kind of lean forward and you know, push through some of the bureaucracy that might normally exist in a large organization. So the team did that. And they were helped us acquire Chromebooks, as was mentioned, wireless streaming devices, accounts for things such as Kahoot. If you don't know what a Kahoot is, ask your daughter, your children, your grandchildren on what those is. I didn't know what that was until my daughter introduced me to that. We transformed the curriculum, as was discussed, from death by PowerPoint, in-class exercises, in studies, videos, activities, the kinds of things that you would expect somebody who has a master's degree to maybe gravitate towards, as opposed to sitting in a classroom for 8 hours a day watching slides. So the instructors drove that themselves, right? These initiatives happened before the pandemic, but really put us in a good position to be successful during the pandemic. Kind of an anecdotal story. We, March of last year, right, we canceled one class, and we're going to cancel the next class in June, which is our senior course. It's a two-week course. I got a phone call slash email from Admiral Galinis' predecessor, Admiral Moore, and said, I didn't get a vote in that. So we talked about it, and he said, I want you to go virtual. And we had about 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks to pivot to go virtual. And it was, again, pushed me, it pushed us to do that. And it was probably the best decision that we made to get us ready for the next year that came. So, again, all about kind of getting out of your comfort zone and pushing you harder than you think you can go. So I thank Admiral Moore for that. My second commitment was to leading the engineering officers community implementation of the Navy Leader Development Framework, which, again, the Admiral mentioned. This task fit right in line with the mission of the school, so that was not an issue, but it certainly was a different role for the school than what we had traditionally done in the past. Pretty much, if you went to Kim Engineering Duty Officer School, you would come out for 5 weeks, you'd go away, come back 10 years later for 2 weeks, go away. You know, it really was kind of a transactional-based relationship, I would submit. We've tried to change that to something that's more enduring across the community, and the Leader Development Framework has allowed us to do that. It's been mentioned, it was the Navy's gold standard, at least according to the VCNO. So I'll take that. And the latest version, which I was hoping to get signed out by the Admiral, but I think before this date, but I think we're going to wait a little bit on that. But we've got the developmental goals for the whole community, a whole community-run leader development ecosystem, such as book clubs, discussion forums, continuous learning seminars, and as was mentioned, our own podcast, which you were a guest on, sir. So, again, something I never thought I would be doing is running a podcast, but we have an officer in the community that's passionate about it and does a fantastic job. So, again, kind of moving things forward. From a schoolhouse perspective, we've incorporated coaching into the curriculum, junior officer-driven mentoring scenarios. We continue to evolve and adapt that framework based on the needs of the community. It's not about me. It's about what the community needs going forward. And it has been really the most satisfying job and endeavor of my professional career to be able to take part in that and have that as something in my legacy. And Phil and I have talked about this, and I think it really is going to evolve even more under his leadership, and I can't wait to see where you take it, Phil. So all this work, as I discussed, is performed here at the schoolhouse. It's on the backs of a very small staff. None of this stuff could be done without them. So it's the only thing that my third commitment was to their personal and professional development, and to create an environment where work was challenging, but also rewarding and fun. So only they would be able to say if that was successful, so I challenge you to ask them that individually. But as far as I can tell, it seems that that's so. Every objective we undertook in the last 3 years was driven by them, their creativity, initiative, commitment to delivering relevant, high-quality training to the students resulted in the tremendous transformations that have been discussed about this morning. And they're well-positioned to take the school and the community to even higher places in the future. The high-performing nature of the command cannot be understated. I've had the pleasure of working with an exceptional group of civilian and military coworkers who have, quite frankly, made my job pretty easy. Tim, Nicole, Vet, Matt, Keith, Cassandra, Lenora, Eduardo, you all are the reason I consider this a successful tour. Your proactive, can-do attitudes, focus on the mission, support of your teammates has ensured our success. And Aaron and Tanya, the two newest members to the team, what I've seen for you the last few months, you're going to take it to greater places as well. So I think the school is in the best position it's been to deliver than I know of in the last 21 years as I've been an engine duty officer. So thank you for that. To punctuate the importance of the work of our team, that our team performs every day, please permit me to take a brief moment to recognize one of our teammates.
Lieutenant Junior Grade Quintero Vera, please join Captain Davis on stage. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the presentation of the military award. This is to certify that the Second Marine Corps Commendation Medal to Lieutenant Junior Grade Eduardo Quintero Vera, United States Navy, for meritorious achievement while serving as administrative support for the Engineering Duty Officer School from 18 January to 30 May 2021. Lieutenant Junior Grade Quintero Vera became a force multiplier at the command while the staff was down two members. His efforts ensured seamless execution of basic courses 21B1 and 21B2, senior course 21S1, and daily operations at the command. He managed the update and release of the Engineering Duty Officer Leadership Development Framework version 3.0, provided key feedback from the reserve perspective, and ensured the resulting documentation supported the entire engineering duty officer community, active and reserve. By his unswerving determination, personal initiative, and loyal dedication to duty, Lieutenant Junior Grade Quintero Vera reflected credit upon himself and upheld the highest traditions of the United States Naval Service. For the Secretary of the Navy, signed Scott A. Davis, Captain, United States Navy, Commanding Officer.
So Eduardo is a reserve officer who we brought on board last year during some staffing challenges that we had. Just goes to show the active reserve integration we have as engineering duty officers, that the community was able to pivot, bring him on board, and he's been on board for 6 months. And I think this week is when he goes back to his day job, back at the Warfare Center working for Captain Hoffman. So thanks for loaning him to us. And Eduardo, thank you so much for all that you've done for us. So as I mentioned, although this is not my retirement speech, it is the last official event that I'll be attending. Here goes a little bit of waxing. To my Combat Systems Board of Director brothers, Tim Atkinson, John Hill, John Keegan, I can't express strong enough to you, or sincerely enough to you, your mentorship, guidance, counsel, and most importantly, friendship has meant to me. To have friends who I can confide, complain, celebrate, and even sometimes conspire with, yes, has been a comforting and consistent thread in my weekly routine for the last 16 years. Our weekly therapy session has always been a bright spot. In even the most disastrous weeks, I'll miss the business of nurturing and growing Kennecockers with you, but I'm sure our friendship will endure. So, Tim, thank you for being here and representing. I'm hopeful, sure, John and John are on the big stream as well. So thank you as well. Thank you for helping me become a better officer, a better leader, and a better person. Appreciate that. Mom and Dad, I'm so glad you could both be here today, and Eric as well. Extra special surprise, my brother last time he was in California was when I was in San Diego in 1992, to see me, I should say. So glad you can come out. I owe my success as a man, husband, and father to both of you, and thanks for being here and being a great example for me to emulate. I love you both. Lori, the love of my life, and McKenna, the apple of my eye. I'll save most of the mushy stuff for the retirement ceremony. But suffice it to say, without your love and support, this tour, as well as many others, would not have been successful or as enjoyable. Our family has been through at the center of every career decision I've made over the last 21 years together. You've both been unconditionally supportive and willing participants in that journey, And thank you. I thank you and love you both very much. So in conclusion, this tour has reinforced for me how truly unique and special the engineering duty officer community is. I've been able to observe how such a small officer community, or about 1% of the entire Navy officer corps, can have such a huge impact on the entire Navy. And I think I know how. To paraphrase one of my former commanding officers, Rear Admiral John Ailes, those who fly as a matter of routine are held in awe by those whose feet have never touched the ground. This perfectly describes my experience in the EDO community. From the outside looking in, I believe we are flying. We are flying because of the support and guidance of amazing leaders like Admiral Galinis, the entire flag wardroom, and those who have come before us. We are flying because of the rigorous and time-tested professional development crucible we grow up in and are trained in. We are flying because of our deep-rooted culture of mentoring, personal development, and commitment to growth. But most of all, we are flying because of the 1,200 active duty and reserve engineering duty officers who tirelessly conduct the business of the Navy day in, day out, to ensure our children and our children's children can enjoy the same freedom and opportunities that we have been afforded. So is this charge I leave to you, Phil, and the entire EDO community, which I love so dearly, never stop flying. I will now read my orders. From Commander, Naval Personnel Command, Moncton, Tennessee, subject, Beeper's Order number 0648, official retirement orders for Captain Scott Allen Davis, USN. Your request to be transferred to the retired list was approved by the Secretary of the Navy when directed by reporting senior, detached in May 2021 from EDO School, Port William, California, proceed to home of selection. Signed, John B. Now, Vice Admiral, U.S. Navy, Commander, Naval Personnel Command. Commander, Naval Personnel Command. Captain Malone, I'm ready to leave.
Ladies and gentlemen, Captain Philip Malone, prospective commanding officer, engineering duty officer school.
I shall now read my orders. From Commander, Naval Personnel Command, Millington, Tennessee, subject, Buper orders 0341, official orders for Captain Philip E. Malone, U.S. Navy. When directed by reporting senior, detach in April 2021 from Program Executive Officer Carriers, Washington, D.C., and report no later than May 2021 to Engineering Duty Officer School, Port Hueneme. Upon arrival, report to the commanding officer, EDO School, as his relief. Signed by John B. Newell, Vice Admiral, U.S. Navy, Commander, Naval Personnel Command. I'm ready to leave you, sir. Sir, I believe you.
I stand relieved. I've been relieved as long as EDO School.
Very well. I'm assuming command of EDO School.
Very well.
Ladies and gentlemen, the commanding officer of Engineering Duty Officer School, Captain Philip Malone.
Thank you, sir. All right, thank you very much for everyone being here today. Admiral Galinis, Captain Boone, Chaps, appreciate it. Captain Hoffman, thank you for being here. I also want to thank Admiral Galinis and Admiral Garvin for the opportunity to serve here at EDO School and continue to execute this very important mission. I want to thank Scott and his family for the superb work that's been done here over the last 3 years. Your support, obviously, very important to that. There's every indication that EDO School is hitting on all cylinders and effectively meeting its mission, and it's a testament to your dedication and hard work, Scott. Thank you. Given the challenges we've all faced here since March 2020, it's a true accomplishment that the EDO School continues to execute its mission, meet its throughput, as well as be that lead for the community. And Scott, you not only ensure that we've hit all the training objectives, but you've also served as that focal point for the EDO community as the lead for the leadership development framework and those other important initiatives that I hope can continue with that same gusto. And I also want to thank you for your 30 years of service to our Navy and our nation. Thank you very much. My wife, Monica, thank you for your continued support and willingness to move yet again. Your resilience through it all is an inspiration to me and our kids. To the staff of EDO School, Mr. Haney, Captain Nigro, XO, the others, thank you for the preparations you've made for my relief and to ease my transition here. The turnover material, the schedules, which keep changing, the brief material, The products you put together were first class, and they've made a great initial impression on me. Thank you. More importantly, your enthusiasm for the mission of the school has been impressive, and it's increased my excitement for what I'm about to take on. So thank you again for that. You've met every challenge of COVID, and you've rapidly adapted the tools and methods we deliver content to the students, and that will increase the effectiveness of the school. Well done. So in shipbuilding, we had this model we call the 1-3-8 rule. So the basic concept here is that 1 hour spent in the shop environment, that same task, if you had to do it in the dry dock, where you're more constrained, would take you 3 hours. If you don't get that work done and you got to move to the pier when the ship's out of the dry dock, it's going to take you 8 hours. We also have a rule that says a man hour is about $100 to pay for. So that means you want to get as much work done in the shop as you can. You want to execute as close to what we call CPI of 1.0, but you got to do that with the right preparation. So as the former program manager for carriers, where it takes 50 million man hours to make a carrier, we really focus on trying to make sure we get that work done in the shop. But the secret to hitting that shop work is the front-end engineering and the planning. You need to have the design complete and all the work packages in place to execute. That is what this school does for our Navy. This high-performing team, the small staff, is the front-end engineering that has to be done in order for our future naval engineers, who control an enormous piece of the Navy's overall TOA, to execute the mission. You look at programs like Columbia class, the Ford class, Aegis missiles, strategic system program, huge impacts on our Navy, and very important. We have the enormous responsibility to improve the professional proficiency of the engineer duty officer community and ensure that our next generation of acquisition and sustainment professionals are ready. And I look forward to that challenge. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, while Captain Davis has decided to conduct his retirement ceremony separately, the EDO school staff would like to recognize his leadership of EDO school and his 30 years of service. The executive officer of the Engineering Duty Officer School, Commander Aaron Woolsey, will now present the shadow box. Captain, please accept this token of our sincere appreciation for your vision and leadership over these past 3 years. The shadow box has become a traditional retirement gift throughout the Navy. Each item in the shadow box is significant in that it summarizes the service member's service to their country.
Thank you.
Bosun, post the side boys.
Side boys, left, face, forward, mark. Left or right, face.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the benediction and remain standing for the departure of the official party. Chaplain Kenyon will now deliver the benediction. Let us pray.
Dear Lord, we gather here today to witness this time-honored tradition. I also consider the leadership that we're all called to exemplify in our own lives, the highest rank to those. Render to us all the courage and conviction to lead. You be our comfort and our guide. Give us the reassurance that you're a shield around us, whatever present help in time of need. Grant my brothers and sisters resolution so that in all things they may serve without reproach. Encourage them while we also encourage one another. We ask that you would continue to bless us and keep our nation and our forces in your gracious care. May you always be glorified through all the things that we do as we strive daily to faithfully serve you and our country. Inspire us today with the honor, courage, and commitment those brave souls who have gone before us. Bind us to never take the blessing of the Lord for granted, and continue to bless every sailor, marine, soldier, airman, and coast guardian who faithfully serve and sacrifice. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Strike eight bells. Naval Sea Systems Command, departing. Strike four bells. Captain, United States Navy, departing. Strike four bells. Captain, United States Navy, departing. Strike four bells. Engineering Duty Officer School, departing. Bosun, post the side boys.
Side boys, left or right? Face. Forward, mark.
Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes today's ceremony. You are all cordially invited to the reception directly behind you, which will start in a few minutes with the ceremonial cutting of the cake. Please join me in congratulating Captain Davis on his successful command tour and Captain Malone on his assumption of command.
How are you guys?
My guess is that the speech writer gets in counterfeit.
I